Welcome to Core Performance Resilient Leadership Series, where brilliant, resilient leaders share uncommon secrets and strategies to succeeding in life and business. Now, here's your host, Julie.
Hello, everyone. I'm your host, Julie Hutchinson, founder and CEO of Core Performance and creator of the Resilient Leadership Series, where I get the honor of interviewing fascinating, big-hearted leaders who have brilliant minds and are resilient in the face of adversity. Today, I have the honor of introducing Steve Seiden, who is president and founder of Acquire Data Solutions, which is a technology and engineering solutions provider specializing in solving customers' complex problems throughout their engineering lifecycle. This ranges from research and development, design, tests, and production. Steve received his undergraduate degree in computer science from American University, as well as two engineering master's degrees from North Carolina State University. Steve's real passion is sharing his leadership qualities, which this includes compassion, innovation, stability, and trust. And we're going to get into this more in detail here in just a minute. Steve has co-authored three articles on automated contact tracing, introduced two partnerships for the CMMC, which is Cybersecurity Maturity Model Certification, and green manufacturing, as well as hosting nearly 50 interns virtually this summer. Steve serves on the board of OnRamp and Biteback. He also works as the PTA president and vice president of his children's school. Steve, welcome. So happy that you're here today.
Thank you, Julie. It's an honor to be on your program, and thank you for reaching out to me and making this happen.
Yeah, you're very welcome. And as I just shared with the audience, you've had some pretty major accomplishments, and being the president of your company for 23 years, I'm sure that you've had to face some challenging times. And we would love to hear about your resilient leadership style and how you faced adversity and what has contributed to your resilience.
Sure. I was actually brought up by two entrepreneurial parents. So my dream when I left college was to actually start my business out of graduate school. Didn't know how that was going to happen, but it did. So I was able to start a business pretty much 3 weeks after ending my graduate school career. And what I thought I knew and what I knew were completely different. And when I started the business, I was an extrovert. So I loved to be with people. I knew how to embrace conflict. But I didn't really know how to have self-compassion for myself in that. So for me, when I started the business, I thought I would be able to close a deal every 2 weeks and just make the business go and have these great returns like lots of businesses have. Well, that certainly wasn't the case. And basically, I thrashed myself in ways that were really hurtful to myself and to the business and my family just because I didn't know any better. So I had to create resiliency because I thought I was the biggest loser in the world if I didn't close a deal every 2 weeks, which on paper sounds crazy. But we live in these worlds that we put ourselves in really a prison because we don't know better when we're young how to get that resiliency.
So well said. I'm sure there's a lot of entrepreneurs listening to this that we tend to have high expectations. And when we don't meet those expectations, we really make ourselves wrong. And I love what you said about self-compassion, because what I find is so many people can be their own worst enemy until they learn self-compassion. So I'd love to dive into that a little bit more on how you actually learn self-compassion.
So on paper, you would think that our brains are our best friends because they're in our body and they actually should be the ones that contribute to our success. But actually, many times our brains are our worst enemies because we can't think through all the problems ourselves, and we need other people and we need opinions, and we're afraid to share our inner suffering. There's a great woman, Tara Brach, who has an expression that says, pain plus resistance equals suffering. So we all sort of have resistance to this and we suffer. And for me, as I mentioned before, I sort of thrashed myself if I didn't have a success or whatever I deemed successful in some period of time. And you have to replace that endorphin or that high or that fix when you get to that low. And entrepreneurship or leadership in general is manic. You know, there's a lot of ups and downs, and a lot of people don't like to talk about what's going on internally. And without being able to express yourself internally or creating emotional resiliency for yourself, it's problematic. So I had to learn how to, first of all, understand that I wasn't alone in anything I thought. One of the things that I love is sort of group therapy or group session, because it allows you to normalize your experience. So like as a parent, you might go crazy because it takes you a half an hour to put your kid's shirt on. And you think you're the worst parent that ever lived because you can't get your kid's shirt on. But then you go to a parent group and you find out they can't get their kid's shirt on either. So it normalizes your experience to suffering so that you can actually create space for yourself and create compassion for yourself, because it's my belief that without self-compassion, you can't really have confidence, because you can't really learn to be confident without giving yourself that space to fail or be imperfect or learn to try.
I love that, giving yourself space to fail. I think too, as business people and people lead as leaders, we become very hard on ourselves. And one of my favorite sayings is, it's okay to feel this way. Because how many times do we feel a certain way and then we make ourselves wrong for feeling that way? And it goes back to that saying that you just had shared, pain and resistance equals suffering. So if we're feeling that pain, to just feel it, to just go with it, let it move through you. I always like to say, emotions are energy in motion. So having emotional resilience is being able to feel that energy, not beat yourself up, let it flow right through you, so then you can move on to what you choose. So share with the audience maybe something in your life where something went completely the opposite direction of what you thought it was going to be, didn't meet your expectations. How did you bounce back? How did you become resilient and move through it?
So when I started the business, I brought my father and my sister in the company. My sister is the oldest of three and I'm the youngest of three. And it doesn't matter if it's your father or sister or not. There are plenty of times that people bring people into companies because you believe that they're smarter than you, they can do more than you, or you give them that deference because they're older than you. And so there's been plenty of examples in ADS that I have brought people in because I thought they were the right person. And I thought they were the right person because I believe they had things I didn't. And I left the growth of the business up to those people because I thought that they were like me. An example is when I started the business 23 years ago, my primary goal, and I was 30 years old, I had no family, wasn't married, was when I turned 50 to go around the world with my family. So October of 17, May of 18, I turned 50 on August 3rd, 2017, and we left October 17, and we went around the world for 7 months. So I left a guy in charge that I thought would be the right guy. And it turned out that it wasn't. And when I got back, I was very fortunate that there was enough of the business left that I, over the last 2 years, could grind it back out and be where we are today, even though we're just going through a pandemic. So certainly I thought having people in charge that knew the business for many years would drive it in the same manner that I might. And that just didn't occur. And luckily I had enough emotional resiliency and self-compassion to know I needed to pick up the pieces and just get going again. And that's what we've done.
So I'm sure you learned some lessons about hiring people. And as leaders, I always like to say, I hire for exactly what you said, our weakness or what we're not good at. And when we hire for that, we think that they're going to help take the company to the next step. So what have you learned about hiring people? Do you have any special things that you take them through, like assessments or tests to make sure that they're the right person, or do tests for resilience? Or what do you look for when you're hiring somebody?
Actually, I take them through an unorthodox interview style where they get to know me. Because in a small business, if you don't like me or don't like my jokes, they don't get any better. So if there's not alignment in the personality, because I believe that people can have technical skills and they can be good at any of their technical skills. And I think we all know if you're just left alone to do the technical part of the job, anybody can get that done. It's all the rest of it that's hard. The interaction of people, the delays, it's really the people component of business that is challenging. And so I lead with our values. So our values are very important to us. And I lead with the premise of self-compassion. I understand that, and I lead that way because if they think it's sort of hocus pocus or nonsense or non-believer, I know they're not the right person for me. And really, as you grow a company, as a leader, the people have to fit into your style and into what you want them to become. And it's our job as leaders to move the pieces on the chessboard. And if you can't get people to understand that they are filling holes and their own weaknesses and they are ego-based, it becomes very difficult.
Mm. Sounds like you're really creating a special culture there. So I hear you talking about hiring people with the right personality, people that get your jokes because they're not going to change or get any better, as you would say. So having that right personality and having that culture, can you talk a little bit more about culture?
Sure. So we spent a lot of time in 2020 redefining our culture. And we've had a lot of new people come into the business. And it's been wonderful because they fit the culture. We lead with talking about our values, which is family friendly and life learner and stretching and grit and teamwork and loyalty and empowerment. And we really want people that get those things and want to be those things and want to become those things. So it's funny, not funny. Funny is certainly the wrong word. In May, we lost one of our longtime stockholders and a guy that was in the business through November of 19, and then we rehired a COO and he died 10 days later, both from what I think is COVID-related stuff. Mm-hmm. So we've really come together amazingly through this pandemic and really stretching through this culture and resiliency. One of my newest hires has been terrific. She has a 15-month-old baby and she for a while had baby in one arm, keyboard in the other. And she had to go, and daycare's opened again, but she didn't have the resources to go and send her child to daycare as often as she wanted. So we have supplemented that, her income, in order to, so that she can have that space to be who she wants to become.
Oh, beautiful. I can really feel your compassion for other people. And I'd first like to pause and just give you my condolences on the loss of two very important people in your company, especially due to this COVID-related illness. So my condolences for you there. I know that leaves a huge void in the company, and I can tell that just by the story that you shared with the new mother, how you really help your employees. How do you bounce back as a leader of this organization, and you've got these employees there? How do you bounce back from the loss of these two people and keep your employees engaged and keep them looking up versus going into feeling of the sadness and the loss and the grief?
That's a great question. I'm not sure I know the exact answer, except that we did it. And we got on a call that, you know, because we all knew what happened. And I was in tears. This man was just a guy I was looking for so long. And, you know, we talked at 10 o'clock in the evening on May 20th, and he was gone by 7 o'clock in the morning the next day. And that was a huge punch in the stomach. And what was amazing is that everybody stepped up. Everybody believed in what we were doing. And they surrounded and they supported me. They gave me the space to get through it, as we gave each other the space to get through it.
Sounds like you had quite an amazing team.
We took time off. I said, you know, go take the rest of the week off. This was a big blow. We had to go call our customer. Our customers were incredibly compassionate. Mm-hmm. It was just an incredible time, and and his daughter actually worked for the company and still does. And it's amazing story that she has the grit and determination to come back and support the company.
Sounds like a big family. You guys are all seeing each other as a big family.
We try, you know, obviously people leave the family, right? People go to college, people graduate, people do what they do, right? And that hurts too at times, right? Because when you invest in people and they leave, that you want them to go and better their lives and be that person they want to become. And sometimes they can't do that where they are. And that's okay too. Mm-hmm. And learning that is a lesson in itself, because sometimes you got to let go of people and sometimes they come back. And we've had people leave and come back, and it's been great.
That speaks volumes of your company and your culture, because when people leave, sometimes they leave because they think the grass is greener on the other side. And just the fact that they're coming back says a lot.
We believe people like warm water. So we try to not make it too cold and make it too hot. We try to keep it at the right temperature.
That's beautiful. And I can really hear in this conversation about these qualities of leadership coming through that are so important to your compassion, trust, not just trust in yourself, but trust in your employees, creating that stable environment. The other tenet that you talked about in leadership is innovation. And I'd like to shift a little bit more into your passion, because you've created something for the past five summers, and then you did something for, I guess it was a six-week course, a STEM literacy program for underrepresented technology students from Washington, D.C. schools. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Sure. So five summers ago, we had an opportunity to go into one high school with three kids and teach them around robotics and just sort of STEM. And that has grown in the last five summers from three kids from one high school to 50 kids from nine high schools. And what happened was on March 15th, two things happened around innovation. One was, how do you teach a kid who might never go back to school the things they need to know to get a job? So we took STEAM at the time, which is science, technology, engineering, art, math. And I started talking to my daughter, and she said, you know, we don't really learn about the economy in school at all. So we turned that to teams, because coming out of the pandemic or during the pandemic, teams is what gets us through. And we turned that into technology, economy, arts, marketing, and socialize. And we created a six-week curriculum where it had to be virtual, that we could teach these kids how to socialize. Because most of these kids showed up with their cameras off, didn't talk, and the most important value they got out of the 6 weeks was socialize, and how they learned that, as one person said in the program, closed mouths don't get fed. And that was really powerful for me for a sophomore in college to say these to high school kids. And what we do is we created a program that's like a camp. So we have a teacher run it, and then we have college students be the counselors, and then we have high school kids be the campers. And the college kids teach down to the high school kids these technologies and concepts, because college kids think they know something when they're in college. But when you have to teach down to people and actually teach something that they should know in technology to somebody else, they find out that that's really difficult. So we've created this hierarchy so that the college kids can do that. And what's unique about Washington, D.C. is that the D.C. government pays these kids from 14 to 24 years old to be in our companies. So I hosted 50 interns without paying a dime for them, just creating the curriculum and getting these college kids to run the program, which we paid out of pocket for some of that, and DCPS, Department of Employee Services, paid for some of those as well. So it's a fabulous program that only exists two places in the country that I know of, Washington, D.C. and New York City. And I'm a big believer right now that there's a lot of opportunities in urban areas that do not exist in rural areas. So we're trying to move this into rural areas, because we believe that kids need these opportunities in STEM literacy in order to really realize what they can be doing in their own careers.
Sounds like an incredible program. two pieces in there, the socialization aspect of it. As we've all seen with the younger generation these days, they typically live on their phones. I heard a story one time that a mom was driving her daughter, her young teenage daughter, and her friend to a soccer practice. And they were sitting in the back seat together, completely silent. And the mom looked back and said, you know, I thought we would be having dialogue. And they said, oh, we are. We're texting each other. And she laughed and said, well, why are you texting each other? You're sitting right next to one another. And I think kids today grow up texting, and they learn that art of socialization and true human connection. So I love that this is a big part of this team's training that you're doing. And I've also heard that when you teach is where you really begin to learn. So having college kids teach younger kids what they've learned, it helps to solidify what they've learned and then help to understand what they're teaching also on a deeper level. So this sounds like an absolutely wonderful program. Steve, if people would like to get some information about it, or if they're listening to this and saying, wow, that could be something that we could use in Austin, Texas, or Nebraska, is there an opportunity that they can contact you and maybe bring something similar to their area and to their schools?
Yes, and we're working on a press release right there. We had one press release about this already this summer, but they can certainly contact me at my email, which we can give out now or at the end. I don't know how you want to work that, Julie.
Yeah, go ahead and share your email right now.
So this is on audio, so it's a little tougher, but it's Steve, S-T-E-V-E, dot Seiden, S-E-I, E as in David, E-N as in Nancy, at Acquired Data, which is A-C-Q-U-I-R-E, E as in David, A, T as in Tom, A.com. I assume that somewhere you'll have that written down.
I'll have it underneath the description of this as well.
Perfect.
So fantastic. So is this something that you're going to be doing again next year for the students?
We're already planning it, and we're changing teams actually to Mastery, which is STEAM, which with an R and a Y. And Mastery stands for Mindset, Arts, Story, Technology, Economy, Reflection, and You.
Beautiful.
And we're tying that into sort of recreating learning. So there's three people that we're trying to create legacy around, okay? And those three people are Sir Ken, who is an amazing educator who just passed away in 2020, a couple weeks ago. The second one is John Lewis, who just passed away recently and brought this whole social justice to bear. And the third is Jane Goodall with Nature and Animals. So combining this nature and animals and social justice and education piece together to create legacy around what these three people embody.
Really beautiful, and across references of so many different, like you've got nature in there, which I think is so beautiful. The other thing that I really love is that the mastery starts with mindset. It's been so often said that mindset is 85% of what you're doing, that 15% is really about the strategy. Of course, we have to have strategy. We have to have an understanding of technology. We have to have an understanding of complex systems. It's the mindset that we bring to certain things that really sets us apart. And if we have a powerful mindset, an optimistic mindset, that's what helps to build that resilience. And that's what helps to get us through things.
Julie, I have a joke for you. Do you know what a definition of a pessimist is?
What's that?
An optimist with experience.
Well, an optimist with experience that hasn't cultivated their mindset is what I would add. Because
exactly.
a true believer in mindset would cultivate that. And I have a saying that I love to, this is one of my mantras that I say, is that things don't happen to me, things happen for me.
Agreed.
And when I made that shift of things happen for me, I started looking at the world differently. Instead of what's wrong, I can't believe this happened, this person did this, or this person did that, I went from codependence to co-empowerment. And so
Agreed.
It is a mindset, is such an important piece of how we function in this world, whether it's business, relationships, I mean, in every domain.
And I, in that same vein, I have a saying that says, if your needle hits my haystack, it's for a reason, because I would never find your needle in my haystack. So I believe in collision marketing. I believe that you make as many collisions as possible, because collisions is where things happen. So yes, you put yourself out there. And I teach two things to all my people. One is being a cluster buster, and one's being a bowling ball.
So you're more cluster buster and bowling ball.
To be a cluster buster, typically when there's a group of people and you're on the outside, how do you feel?
If you're on the outside, you're feeling left out.
Right. And left out syndrome is a big thing. It's a real thing. And why do people feel left out? Why don't people just step in the middle? Is that the group or is that them?
Typically them, for fear.
Right. So I teach to be a cluster buster. If you see a cluster, go break it up, because nobody's keeping you on the outside except you.
Hence the bowling ball.
Everyone's a target. And everyone has gold. I teach people every day that everybody has gold. And if we don't scratch the surface or dig a little bit, we'll never find it.
We all do. It's all just waiting to be uncovered. We all have our zone of genius, and we all have our gold. And we certainly have uncovered a lot of gold today from you sharing about your journey and your leadership style and what your passions are. And I just want to applaud you for what you're doing for these children. I think it's fantastic. And congratulations for 23 years in business, being successful and making a difference in the world. It's been a pleasure having you on the show. Again, if anybody would like to get a hold of Steve, you can reach him at steve.seiden, S-E-I-D-E-N, at acquiredata.com. And I'll have that email address below this video as well. Steve, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it. And thanks for your time, and thanks for the opportunity.
Thanks for listening to the Resilient Leadership Series. To learn more about Julie and Core Performance, go to www.coreperformance.us and be sure to join our private Facebook group, Leaders Without Limits. We will see you next time.